at the back here. And you can see how the patina has grown back, and you can also see the thickness of the patina. Clearly, whoever made this a long time ago would have done it out of the raw rock, and you would have seen the black rock originally, and not the patina. So the fact that these stone artifacts and tools are completely covered in the patina, I mean, here you can see, it's completely covered. There's the phallus stone for you, both sides. There's, you can't even see a piece of the original black stone underneath. This tells us that we're dealing with something extremely old. And here's the biggest one of them. This is a beautiful example of an old phallus artifact. What they were doing with these, I don't know, but nevertheless, there seem to be a lot of them around. Some of the phenomenal other items that I've picked up is this little carved stone. I have no idea what this is, but it seems like a little statuette or something that was used. I've asked various people in the Department of Arts, the arts departments at various universities, would this qualify to be called a statue? And the answer is most certainly yes. So I call this the oldest statue on earth, because this is also way beyond 100,000 years old, based on the patina growth. All these artifacts I'm showing you here pretty much fall into the 100,000 year plus category. And since we know that humanity is only about 300,000 years old or slightly less, if this was made by humans, then this is probably going between 100 and 300,000 years based on our knowledge of our origins, and also now supported by the patina growth on some of these tools and artifacts. But then what becomes important, oh yeah, I'll also show you this. This is, I found the statue and this lying about 10 meters apart on one of the slopes that I was walking through. This is a very unusual item. I mean, look at this. It's absolutely amazing why anybody would want to sculpt it or mold a stone into this kind of shape. Once again, note the patina, how thick the patina is. Originally, it should have been that color, and it is now this color. So you can see how old this tool is. I don't know if it was inserted into something so that would stick out. You now all know that I believe that these are just part of tools and artifacts that were used for creating Sacer technology, and I'll show you now what I mean by that, using sound as a source of energy, like laser technology. But this is a spectacular artifact that I'm very, very proud of in my little position. And then obviously it continues, as you can see here, the cone-shaped tools, these beautifully cone-shaped tools. These are not to stab or attack somebody with, as our historians and archaeologists would like to think. Here's a typical example of what archaeologists would refer to as a stone axe, a handheld axe, from the so-called Stone Age era. You can see this is what you will find in most museums and examples of stone axes. The cone-shaped tools are something completely different, and that is the common denominator that you find in all these ancient ruins in southern Africa, in Zimbabwe, and so forth. Those go hand in hand with what is referred to as the sacred stones. The sacred stones that are absolutely smooth on the inside. To make this, this is extremely, extremely hard, to make this kind of item with Stone Age tools, just with other stones, is not possible. So whenever you hear people talk about these in South African circles, historic circles and archaeological circles, they're called weights for digging sticks. When people made these, so when they went into the fields to dig for roots and food, they would put this around the stick for extra weight so they could dig more effectively. Now that is the most nonsensical thing that anybody was able to come up with. These are advanced tools, technological tools, used in association with these, and this is really just a frequency converter, these sacred stones. You put one frequency in and another frequency comes out, It converts the frequency. Telecommunications people today use tubes, pipes, to do exactly the same thing. It's called tubing in the satellite industry. They put a frequency, bring a frequency down from the satellite, put it through the tube or the pipe, and a different frequency comes out the other side. It's a very cheap and effective way of changing one frequency to another. Well, here you've got a frequency converter that's not going to break or last forever. And that's why we have hundreds of thousands of these that have been found around Southern Africa. And once again, if you compare the numbers of people that should have been living here during the Stone Age period compared to hundreds of thousands of these items, it just doesn't gel, does it? So, we now know that this is an advanced tool using SASER technology, and these cone-shaped tools, just like our friend Ed Leeds-Carlin in Florida, when he built Coral Castle using ice cream cones in his hands. When the two boys saw him and reported to their parents that they saw the man lifting up the giant blocks using ice cream cones in his hands. Here you go. And this is also in a way reminiscent of the winged bird-like beings in the Sumerian culture holding those pine cones in their hands while watering what seems to be a tree of life or something like that. So we've got a common denominator here of pine cones and cone-shaped tools and artifacts that now suggest that they used advanced technology, especially SASER technology using sound. Now, the fact that I discovered that the stones ring like bells is a huge breakthrough, because that allowed me to realize that the reason why all these stone circles are a different shape, and they are more than 10 million, in fact I now believe that there are probably as many as 20 million, if not more, of these, the more you look into it. But each one is completely unique, and the fact that they are unique represents, as you by now know, the cymatic patterns of the energy fields coming out of the ground. So let me also just show you how some of these other stones ring like bells. This is what I call, and when, as you can see, we find many, many of these elongated stones. This one is full of patina. It's thick patina, so it's quite dull, but you can still hear the effect. And this is a beautiful one. This one actually rings at two different frequencies. Dun, dun, dun. Dun, dun, dun. You can hear the pentatonic scale there, actually. It's beautiful. And then, one of the really interesting mysteries are the birds of Southern Africa, starting with the Zimbabwe birds that closely resemble the birds on a pedestal up in Egypt that were the mascots of the gold miners in Egypt and the Near East. And here we have just a few examples of birds on a pedestal. Sometimes it's just a broad base that narrows down to the top, always somehow angled up, looking at the gods for protection. And this is just one of such examples, dozens of these that I've found, which I believe are the early prototypes of the mascots and the protectors of these very early gold miners. This one was found in the middle of the Karoo while I was stopped to relieve myself while driving for hours and hours from Cape Town to Johannesburg. And this is what I found. Once you know what you're looking for, it's just spectacular what you find. And these bird-shaped stones are quite remarkable. Here's the latest one I found. And if you look online and you just Google Zimbabwe birds, you'll see how these resemble many of those. Well, there are only about 8 of those Zimbabwe birds, but they're spectacular. These being the very basic, I believe, prototypes of those that much later became refined in Zimbabwe. You will also see in the Zimbabwe birds the two circles, just like on the birds from Egypt, that are linked to the five-pointed stars from Egypt. This database, my favorite one, was actually spotted by Louise while we were driving down the mountain. I mean, look at this perfectly carved, I believe it was probably put in the ground, standing like this, it's just very heavy. And looking up at the sky for protection, what you notice is, look how red it is. It's completely red from the patina that has covered it in its original shape. It should have been black like the Hornfell stone. But this is a very, very precious and priceless artifact that is lying here. And you can all come and see it. So these are just some of the things in this museum. It's covered in priceless artifacts. I just might as well just show you these pointed tools. That these pointed tools and stones are not just the little ones. Sometimes you get them in large, they're quite large. Get this, look at this one. And it looks also like it was inserted into something up to that point. And also, remember, they all ring like bells. This one is no exception. Alright, and on that note, that's a little short little tour of my museum. It normally takes at least 2 hours to go through here and explain a lot of the stuff, but just a quick introduction since you can't come here. And thanks for watching.
What I'm going to show you right now. They ring like bells because they're metamorphosized quartzite, which is silica, right? And what is silica good for? Silica conducts sound, as you've now heard, and it also conducts light. And silica can store information. And this is what we use silica for today.
Yeah.
And all the top highest forms of technology right on the outer edge. So,
inside the computer.
Just like the pharmaceutical industry pulled the wool over our eyes and said, we'll extract the active ingredient from the plants so the people can't heal themselves and we can then make the plants illegal, they can't grow them. But we'll sell the active ingredient to them in a bottle and in pill form and have to pay for it. It's the same thing that the technology companies have done. They've extracted the active ingredient, silica, out of the stones and put into modern technology to divide us. That division that I spoke to right up front, that division comes to us in the form of technology. We think technology is a blessing and technology is wonderful. It's not. Technology is a tool of division and enslavement. Just think about that. Because we should not have technology. There's only one highest form of technology that is knocking on the door of source, where it all comes from, and is able to do everything with the technology, just like these ancients knew about. But we are sold it in bits and pieces with obsolescence built into it, so it keeps breaking, and we're constantly going around in circles and buying more stuff because it's where the capitalistic, money-driven society, so that's how they keep us going on and on and on and on. It's a beautiful system. You got to take your hats off to these guys, whoever they are, that are orchestrating this stuff, because it's so spectacularly orchestrated that most of us are completely oblivious of it. So I believe that since silica is at the source and at the core of this, all these ancient sites that we've spoken about, just here and many and all the others, actually carry all the knowledge and information in the stones of the sites. They hold that memory. The stones have got consciousness just like everything else. And the silica inside there is the storage of that knowledge and information in the consciousness. If we can just plug into these rocks at these ancient sites, we'll be able to extract all the information, everything that's ever happened there. But we're too stupid to do that because we've got computers. And guess what? It's always about gold. Got to always bring it back to gold. Because if you don't, you're going to miss the point. More than 75,000 mines, gold mines, have been discovered in South Africa, just around the Lydenburg area, one little town. 75,000 mines. Extrapolate that to the whole of Southern Africa and your mind will boggle. In the 30s, mysterious ancient shafts and tunnels were discovered by gold miners about 100 feet deep, with mysterious tools and objects that were confiscated by the mining authorities, never to be returned or explained. In the 90s, De Beers found a 22,000 feet deep shaft cut with absolute precision, indicating advanced laser technology. He did not know where it came from, who did it, and they obviously don't share that kind of information. And then the northern parts of South Africa in the Volkberg Mountains, this is not an actual picture of it, just a picture to keep you thinking along the lines, let your imagination run wild, but there are dozens of kilometers of underground mines carved with absolute precision, just like De Beers described in the 90s. What's spectacular about these tunnels underground in the Volkberg, from the reports that I've heard from the geologists that told me about this, they're covered with platinum slag. They clearly weren't interested in platinum. Who was in charge of this largest gold mining operation ever? Always Enki, the Sumerian god Enki, the creator of the human race. In the Abzu, Enki plans was conceiving where to build his house, where for the heroes' dwellings to prepare, where the bowels of the earth to enter. That's a translation of the Sumerian tablets. Enki's house, his mines and technology. In the midst of the Abzu, to a place of pure waters, Enki betook himself. In that land, a place of deepness, he determined for the heroes into the earth's bowels to descend. The earth's splitter, Enki there established, therewith in the earth a gash to make. Now that earth splitter sounds something like we're trying to define that the Beers found with which they built those kind of tunnels and shafts, right? Because then it carries on, by way of tunnels, earth's innards to reach, the golden veins to uncover. I'm going to show you that earth splitter, what I believe to be that earth splitter that the Sumerian tablets talk about. Is there a ruin or a settlement that could be linked to Enki? I've showed you already, Great Zimbabwe, the grandest of them all in southern Africa. Totally encoded with the energy fingerprint of Enki. Many energy healers and those that can sense energy have told me the same, and I've seen spectacular images of those energy lines that link Zimbabwe, Great Zimbabwe, to Enki.
That's not the same as Gilgamesh and Enkidu.
Could be.
I'm just wondering.
Could be the same as Gilgamesh and Enkidu. So I see this as Enki's house, possibly also the main laboratory down in southern Africa. Who knows? But it's totally and utterly encoded with Enki. But is there a flagship among these ruins, these 10 million or more ruins? Absolutely. And Jan Heiner needs to be commended for this, for rediscovering what I then called Adam's calendar, which you're now more and more calling Enki's calendar, because just like everything else, everything keeps coming back to this guy Enki. And it's quite spectacular. You can't get away from this. And yet, guess what? It's not just myself that says this and others, but so does Baba Kreda Mutwa. He was initiated there in 1937 as a young African shaman. And guess what? It is not unknown to the ancient African knowledge keepers. They know this as Inzalo Yelanga, or birthplace of the sun. Specifically, emphasis on the S-O-N, because that's where Kreda Mutwa tells me everybody believes that the human race was created. The birthplace of the sun. This is where the first seven Anunnaki females were inseminated with a fertilized egg of the human being and became the birth mothers and the seven goddesses in Hindu tradition that gave birth to the human race. There's an image, a photograph, aerial photograph of Adam's calendar. That's north, there's a stone under it, and that's south. Stone there as well, and north-south goes right between the two central calendar stones. Over there used to be a stone man, what we called a stone man, which Kreda Mutwa calls the clitoris of Mother Earth. And that stone man looked over the two central calendar stones, right over the stone here, which I very soon discovered resembles very strongly a Horus bird. So you got this line looking out east at the rise of the sun, met by the Horus bird, who looks at what? These three stones lying there. You can see this one very clearly, very pointed stone, clearly carved into a point or shaped into a point. If you lift those up, you'll see a perfect alignment. That original circular structure of Adam's calendar. Those three stones over there, that is where it is believed, and there's a long story how this all unfolded over a period of 4 years. I'm condensing them to